begin now. I would first request everyone to switch their mobile phones or put it on silent mode. A very warm welcome. I am Sania Faruqi, and on behalf of Tulika Books, I invite you to the second of our Indus conversations. The first one last month was between Varun Grover and Ian Woolford, and today we have two Ramon Magsaysay Award winners with us, Bezwada Wilson and T.M. Krishna. They will be in conversation with author, writer, and columnist Nilanjana Roy. I would request you all to please come on the not so built up stage. Take the stage off. And before we begin, I would like to give a small token of appreciation from the organizers. Nilanjana, over to you. It's such an honor to be in conversation with two people whose work and art I've admired for such a long time. I hope that all of you at the back can hear clearly, and if you can't, there are seats in the front. So just feel free to come forward. There's about six seats out here if you'd like to sit back, and two that side. Thank you. I wanted to start actually because both Mr. Krishna and Mr. Wilson have done so much work on trying to, in a way, reimagine what the country should be like. Could we start with the three promises that were made by the Constitution: liberty, equality, fraternity? And I wanted to ask you, on a very personal note, what did you see around you of those three qualities in practice when you were growing up, in your families, in your community? It's an interesting point, because what liberty is there if people are forced into being manual scavengers through hereditary or caste-based occupations? And what fraternity can there be if you grow up, as I think all of us do, subtly inculcated with the belief that caste is inferior or superior? Is what I could ask you to start, Mr. Wilson?
Thank you. See, the three important things which you have mentioned, that is actually the Constitution, whole Constitution about liberty to talk really nowadays in the country, it is very difficult. The days has come. But the problem is also, if you don't talk, that is another problem. So we have to talk about that. And liberty ka baat, when we want to really discuss, we have to see that the around us, how it is, the atmosphere. And so when you think about the liberty, actually for me it is coming when the fundamentalism and the fascism, when it is so widespread, then there is no point actually left for the liberty at all. I feel very difficult to even find out where is the liberty like. And equality, of course, I can talk much, because born into the society where in such a unequal, and experience itself is the whole, the life is a unequal. So there we have a space where we can at least talk. But expressions and all is also is a difficult in the country and in the society also. And the childhood experience is also very bad, and which makes many things not to say out also. And another thing is to say openly, it is if some are thinking that I am superior, I felt that is their problem. But later I understood that they are also thinking me inferior. So it is not just somebody's problem, it is, of course, it is my personal problem also. So making them to understand, no, it is, I am not inferior. And the same time I have to tell every time that you are also not superior. So if it is not happened, then there is no point of talking about equality. So it is a big struggle whole life actually, from the childhood and then. And people also talk about, without talking about the caste problem in a country and untouchability, and there is no point talking about the equality. That is also is another big problem. But now the country has changed and we have all development, and we talk about the language also, development, growth and all other. So there is no space for the discrimination, untouchability, and many like poverty. Poverty has gone out of our minds. We as if that we think that where is the poverty now? So we are all so well, and see the metro life. So there are many things, it has just gone out of our senses. So we have to really talk about the India. If you don't talk these things, so we cannot enter or end up with anything. We cannot resolve. And always I ask also, see, I also want a society where is there is no caste discrimination. It does not mean that I want that. So problem here is some are privileged to forget your caste. But my problem is I do want to forget the caste, but it comes repeatedly every minute to my senses and say that what you are. So that struggle, it is not an individual struggle. That whole nation has to start that struggle. We have to struggle. Sangarsh karna, and we have to yaha se bahar. Otherwise there is no point we continuously talking about liberty, equality.
Okay,
I just want to pick off from one statement that he just made about privilege giving you the benefit of forgetting caste. I'm going to pick from that because I come from exactly that position. The truth of the matter is I grew up with this false sense of modernity. And in this false sense of modernity, all these ideas of caste and discrimination in some fashion are all in the past. You live in this sense, in this bubble that is created in a very urban, English-speaking, a certain kind of English-speaking, to be specific, kind of a neighborhood environment where caste is something, caste or any of the discriminations, is something that exists somewhere far away. So actually, in my eyes, everything was equal. I don't think I really saw discrimination. That's the truth of how I grew up. And I grew up in what could be considered a definitely very open family where everything was discussed, like all that. Yet, the idea of discrimination, idea of caste or class, of being something oppressive, being something that truly marginalizes human beings and even reduces them to be considered not even human beings, is something that is not there in the psyche of people like me who grew up in a certain fashion. First, I think there needs to be an acceptance that you are not in touch with that aspect of yourself. Forget about everybody else. Of yourself. I think that I grew up in a very equal fashion. I believe that the people who worked in our house were equal to me. I, of course, treated them very normally. But that idea of the normal itself is such a fishy thing, right? And how does one notice the fishiness? I think that's the first point that I have to ask myself. Is I never saw it. I sang Carnatic music. I saw an audience that came to a Carnatic music concert. They were the normal audience. Why didn't others come? They were interested. What about other art forms? Oh, there are people listening to it. They have their own world. It's a very easy answer. And this answer is very convincing.
So you have the privilege of forgetting, and what was the first time? Do you remember the first time?
Yeah, so I don't think there's this one moment that actually, I don't believe that it happens. I think it's a process of many things that leads to. So first of all, I think this bubble is first of all very, very happy bubble to live in. So you generally like to live in that bubble as much as you want to. You can intellectualize it and read 1500 books about it, yet you'll come back home and sit in the bubble. Now, first we have to acknowledge that reality that we all do. Just because we have this forum and have a chat about it doesn't mean it changes who we are. So for me, I think finally the whole discourse for me did not come from a socio-political angle, or even honestly a self-awareness that came from a certain soul searching of the individual. It finally came from art. It came from the music for me. It came from something that was a research project of a very technical nature. It was trying to recreate a composition that was 150 years old, that nobody knew to sing, from a book. That's the most fascinating thing for me, that one little act could then evolve into so many things. So we recreated this composition. And then my friend and I said, okay, suppose we sing it exactly how it is notated in a book, how would it sound? Okay, we tried doing that project, still ongoing. That first asked me, when I sang it, sang things like how it was written in some treatise, it sounded awful. So the first question that raised for me was an aesthetic question. What is beauty? Is beauty conditioned by my time? Is it beauty conditioned by where I am? Or is it something more? Then the question is, does beauty change depending on who is handling the beauty? Then who is the community handling the beauty? So then that pushes it to another sphere. So the question is, who are the people in the community? That becomes a social question. Who are those who are not part of an artistic community? Now this, in a way, just starts expanding. And expanding in discourse, but becomes far more internal in the search. And that every notion I held completely exploded. And it was a struggle in many ways, because for a musician it's a huge struggle, because there is a sound that you run by. Yeah, you're a political animal, you're a social animal, but there's also an aesthetic of a sound, and then you're saying that sound is a fraud at some level. Then you're shaking everything that you do, and then there's the politics of it. So in a way, this is what actually happened, and it then turned out, like you said, to completely demolish everything I believe was normal. See, one important thing is, I think the people who, all of us, I'll just talk for myself, who live in this bubble, don't really believe that they are oppressing people. They believe that's normal. See, that's the whole problem with it, right? So the normal has to be then snapped out.
And also the recognition that your normal is not the same as the rest of the country is normal. I think that's...
And may just add one thing about equality, fraternity. I think the fundamental aspect is the human being is not an equal creature. The human being is designed to discriminate. The human being is designed to make sure something is more powerful. So as much as the Constitution says it, the problem is that the human being is not designed to be like the Constitution. That conflict has to be first handled.
What you're saying pretty much is that liberty, equality, fraternity, wonderful ideals, but unless you internalize them, and you can't do that unless you actually want them for other people, not just for yourself. And here, I wanted to stick with the personal, Mr. Wilson. In your work from your 20s to your 50s, pretty much, you see a consistent line of you in a way demanding, both of you demanding, that these promises be kept, that they not just exist on paper, but at some level, liberty, being equal, being expressing brotherhood, has to be a lived reality. I just wanted to ask, you describe a pattern of secrets and silences. And there are families trying to hide their occupation from their children. There's a transferred sense of shame between castes. One caste takes on the shame and the uncleanliness of the other. And their lines of purity, pollution, becoming lines of control. And through that, I started to see, through your work and the work of a lot of other people, you start to see another picture of the nation start to emerge as a family, but perhaps an abusive family.
It is actually for me, again, I go back to the concept of the equality. So I feel that when I first heard about the equality, that was any child in the world, I can say that, they had a feeling of the equality. Nobody in the childhood can think that some are very lesser. I don't think that. We are all strongly, I felt. I don't know about others, I cannot watch exactly. I felt this. My mother also made me to understand and continue with the same feeling, that we are all equal and there is nobody is a superior or anything. In front of, under the sky or something, many, many. But the problem, it starts in a very different way. So when all others are thinking all these experiences, one. And identities. So the people who clean the toilets cannot come out and say, like, I am doing like this. And when we go to the school, in my personal experience, when I went to the school, I explained very recently also. So when my turn comes, I am unable to get up and say that I am so and so, and my parents are doing this. So when the turn comes, I have to put my head down and ask my other friends, Apollo. Then I understood why this is happening. The caste entering for even to the untouchable, it is also through process only. It all of a sudden exit aisa nahi hote hai. And I don't think. And when you know that you are untouchable, that is a disaster. The world, whatever disasters so far has seen, much more powerful than the disaster is when the human being, when they know that you are untouchable, you are forever, you are going to be like this, and the whole country and the society is going to see you like this. You will destroy complete your knowledge, your dignity. What? There is no point of dignity. Even self. Then you have to build again. It is, you talk about the reborn, all those things. But I can say that once you know that, for me, my personal experience, I felt there is nothing left. It is everything has gone like. Not just even the down, there is a something you can hold your legs like. Then you have to build again. That kind of a cruelty actually makes everybody to understand why it should continue. Why can't we everybody think about that? People come out of the, actually in the main doors, nobody comes to clean. Comes at the back door to clean the toilets and go. When they're coming and cleaning and going, even the toilet owners, they may not be knowing who is coming and cleaning. Mohase, just they will give the sound, and here you will throw the water. Then they will clean and go away. That is the kind of the identity which we are talking about. So once those people, they want to come out, which identity they want to come out? When there is no identity to tell even. The problem here is in this manual scavenging. It is in such a horrible, first they have to break us, they won't silence. And for us, for me, up to my 19 years old, for me, everybody, including my own people, my community, everybody say, we are doing this work because we are all poor. Second is, we are doing this work because we are illiterates. We don't know any other education and skill. We are doing this work because we are very lazy. We cannot do a hard work. I strongly believe that from my 15th year to 19th year, 4 or 5 years, I used to abuse my own people like anything. Why you can't do hard work like? In 1990, when I came to know that, there is a person called Ambedkar. 1990, I never seen in my syllabus. I studied and I almost dropped all my studies and I came out of the college. Till that time, I don't know about the Ambedkar. It is a fact. When 1990 India started celebrating Ambedkar centenary celebrations, then only I came to know that. Iska pahle, when we turn the pages, we see Gandhi, we see somebody with very big this thing, Tarpan, so Nam, Bal Gangadhar Tilak, and another Tarpan, so Roy, Raja Ram Mohan Roy, like many. But I never seen any Ambedkar like a court wala, me waha nahi dekha syllabus pe. So we believe strongly as a child, as a student, textbook. Not outside the statues and all, we don't believe. Then after Ambedkar only I came to know that we are the scavengers, not because we are the poor. All poor are not doing the scavenging. All illiterates of this country, 40% more than, nobody is doing.
And then you make the connection.
And I connect with her. He said that because you born into particular caste, and the caste has this occupation, and we are all the scavengers. Then only the caste has come into the picture. So caste is in such a way, it is everywhere, but you can't find out anywhere. That is the drama here. This drama we have to break, otherwise there is no solution. So I also said, even you go and say our people, own people, they say,
ये तो भगवान ने हमारा का यही काम दिया सो द एक्सेप्टेंस इंटरनलाइजेशन सो हाउ यू हैव टू ब्रेक वेन अनलेस यू टॉक अबाउट द एक्चुअल द प्रॉब्लम एंड अमंग द स्कैवेंजर्स वेयर एवर देयर इज अ गुड मनी फुल मनी मतलब 20,000 30,000 देयर द 99% आर मेन वेयर देयर इज अ 20 रुपीस देयर 96% आर वुमेन So you cannot ignore the patriarchy. Sometimes when we talk about the caste, Dalits also, we do say that patriarchy baad mein. There is nothing like a baad mein. We have to address the issue, whatever it comes, that on dot on the surface. Otherwise, there is no.
I have a lot of questions that I'm going to come back to, you know, about that, the movement from 1992 onwards, and realizing that this was not going to be dismantled so easily. But first, if I could come to you, Mr. Krishna. This question about purity and pollution. Here you are practicing music, something that gives you a great deal of pleasure. At what you've mentioned one of the moments where you start to realize that there's a problem. But this whole question of structural silences and what is considered pure and polluted even in your field. Would you like to talk a little bit more about that?
Yeah. Primarily the idea of purity. The problem with art or with the artistic discourse is it's so nuanced that a lot of things kind of go through the holes and the crevices. And therefore, the arguments on aesthetic identity, arguments on beauty, arguments on purity are many times passed off as arguments that are purely musical. That are purely about the art, about how the art should be, about the traditional art. But 99% of the time, it's got very little to do with the art, and it's got everything else to do with the politics of the art. And therefore, the idea of purity, even in art form, and this is not just a Carnatic story, this is true of almost most art forms that are practiced. So the idea of what is the pure form of the art form, or what is sung, the content, what should be the emotive quality? What is the experience of the art? What is the elevating idea? It's basically classical musicians in India think they're all levitating at 7 feet above the earth. They permanently think they are levitating. And that's part of this whole nonsense that we've been selling that in some way we are, through the sense of purity. The sense of purity is very important to that sense of where we are. You know, which is why you see some Hindustani musicians actually, I don't want to mention names, who walks with his hand up like this and blesses everybody. I mean, it's totally ridiculous, honestly ridiculous, right? But the point is, it comes from that whole position that when I enter that space of music, somehow I become part of a ritual. And in that ritual, I'm the pontiff. And because I'm the pontiff, I'm elevating the whole sense of the environment, including the people. Now, how do I do that? There are processes in place on how certain things are sung. Question is, what is not sung? Question is, what is highlighted? The question is, what do I emphasize? And how do I hold on to that purity? Now, I will not say that there's not great music happening. I'm not ever saying that, okay? I'm just not discussing it now. But we can't ignore that in that whole process, there is a cultivated sense of purity which is ingrained in patriarchy and caste. Both are equally powerful in that. So pollution happens. So interesting, people say, isn't art creative? Isn't there always new things coming? See, the idea of creativity is fine, especially for art forms that have a history, so to speak. And in India, everything goes to approximately 2000 years. Now maybe 5000, I don't know when we are, okay? So what happens is, in that whole cultivated linear progression that we have made for ourselves, which is musicologically flawed and also in every other fashion flawed, but that apart. So what happens in that is, as long as the so-called changes happen at the surface level, basically you can make changes to saying, I'm going to sing this phrase or that phrase, I may not sing this, then it's all fine. But if I'm going to go slightly deeper and say the fundamental idea you're discussing is flawed, let's chop the legs off and fall, then it becomes problematic. The classical doesn't want to collapse and get up again. And when I say classical, I'm also talking about everything else that goes with the idea of the term classical. So, but it's essential that we all fall and get up, but the classical will never fall. So there will be always this purity, this sense of socio-political construction that will never be touched. Never be touched. Everything on top, produce great music or great art, that's a different thing. But that will be constantly tweaked. So pollution happens when you go to the fundamental and say there is a fundamental problem in how we are even receiving, giving, sharing this art. Therefore, unless you address the fundamental, the stuff on top is just a bit of mumbo jumbo and very self-serving. It's a very self-serving environment. Art is a very, very beautiful environment. We all know each other. We all know each other's sound. We all know what sound to give. Just keep giving it.
Yeah.
Right? The other thing is, one thing that is important, I think, in this discourse is the idea that of rejection is something the top bracket do not like. We don't like to be rejected and thrown out. If anybody rejects us, we say the other person does not know. The other is not evolved enough. The other does not have the nicety. Or like Mr. Wilson said, or the other person is not just capable of it. The other person is not, it's just too complicated. So one of the problems in the discourse is also the fact that you don't want to be told that this is rubbish. This music is awful. If anybody said that, I said, guy, there's no music. I want to even consider the possibility that there is something awful here, right?
I was just thinking of the way that, you know, suddenly your entire childhood and I think everybody's life starts to open up. You realize that you're taught work as a kind of caste system as well. Work has its caste, and some kinds of work are wonderful and some and sacred practically. And others by definition are polluted, though if you look at them, you see that there shouldn't be that much difference between the two. I wanted to ask you a question, Mr. Wilson, about something that seems frivolous, but that probably isn't that trivial, which is the question of happiness. You know, sometimes it feels like the right to happiness is also reserved for a certain set of people. And from the early 1990s, roughly, when you were with the Safai, you'd started the Safai Karmachari Andolan, you start off and you explain to your country that there is a problem, that this is the scale of the problem. You have 1.3 million workers engaged in a job that shouldn't exist. And you might think at that point of time that it's going to take you 3 years, 5 years to get it across. But instead, what happens is that over a 20, 30 year period, what you see is people fudging statistics saying that, no, 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 we've dealt with the problem because we're changing the statistics, we're changing the numbers. In the middle of all of this, where do you actually find happiness? You know, a struggle is also a creative thing. Art is not the only thing that's creative. And do you find it in the lives of people like Narayan Amma? Do you find it in the lives of your colleagues? Where do you start to find things like freedom, happiness, creativity? Where does that come from?
See, one is very clear. When we fully convinced that there is an injustice, so fighting against injustice itself gives the happiness. It is a tremendous happiness. So when you struggle, you don't feel that you are doing something. And there is no measurement also. I don't know, and you also mentioned that I might have felt that 2-3 years or something. But to be frank, I felt that when it is so simple, nobody knows. If I go and tell, tomorrow morning there will be change. That was my understanding when I started my life. And the next day morning, there are the many days, many mornings has gone, many nights has gone. But situation is also changing. I can't say that today nothing has changed. But the way it has to change, it has not happened. That is the, there is a struggle. I can't say unhappy or anything. Because the result are also there. People first, they said that, where is the scavenger? And our own people, they said that if you come, see, what the problem with us is, we also had the, from childhood, we have this, what is happening around us, everything. We don't want to reveal to anybody. That make whole the family and everybody, they are training us not to say this openly, otherwise if you say to everybody, they may discriminate you like. But they are not aware that whether even if you don't tell anybody, everybody knows except you. Everybody knows in the world, or particularly in India, that I am what I am. But my mother even, she tries, because she don't want to give that identity to me. That is the pain. So she protects me not to get that. But the problem is, one point of time I understood that this is complete a kind of a drama. So I can't play the drama without actually getting the script. The actual script is actually to breaking the silence. You must come out and say that I am a scavenger. So what? I am scavenger, not it is because I want to become a scavenger. You made me a scavenger because for you want. But I am a kind of a people, we have no nothing to do. And we are in such a receiving side. But you have to understand what, where you have to place me. In that circumstance, you made me a scavenger, I am struggling. The person who is struggling, why should feel bad? And why I should feel that I am a less than somebody like? Yet conscious when it started, telling for each person and somebody, when we want to go and I decided, we let us go and make a dharma. So everybody said, okay, okay. When the day when we declared, there was not even a single person. Not even a single person. So I went and I seen there, and there is nobody is there. Then I was just waiting, why nobody came? Then I found that one or other, everybody slowly watching who will go first. Then I was just so disappointed, I was just sitting there. And behind me there was a 2-3 women. They said, before you came, we entered into the office and we are analyzing what is happening inside. And we are coming, we are there. Don't think that you are a first. So there are the people who are before person like me. And I cannot claim that this is I am doing or somebody that. That is completely nonsense. That I somehow I cannot do that. They are everybody. Once they, everybody started coming and doing this, every minute you get this happiness. There is no disappointment at all. And the people who are solidarity support, tremendous support. It is a kind of a, that is the name, forever like. It is not for the 2 days support or solidarity. It is lifelong. Until the last toilet destroys, I am there with this moment like. So moment also we have not registered yet. Because we don't require any kind of a registration certificates or anything. People are there, they are fighting for their own. So I don't take this as a happiness. Happiness is in every moment. When there is a fight against injustice, and there are the people in this country, that is the good. However, whatever, actually there are the groups want to destroy that kind of a resilience. But unfortunately, fortunately, they have not succeeded. Still there is a resilience, there is the goodwill, and there are the people who want to fight against the all these kind of a forces. Sometimes people may also brand in me in many, many different ways. But it is okay. That is their opinion. I don't go and enter into their arena. But I, as long as I am here, I am very clear that whatever we are doing, it is not for the one particular community, caste or individual. It is for the whole nation. We are building the nation. The nation has built in the foundations of the inequality. Constitution says the exactly the nation should build on the equality, liberty and fraternity. So there we have to, actually we have to rebuild. And we, everybody must also born from there again. If we want to born. 1950, January 26th, the Republic, that is the most important from there. But I don't want to go back. I have a 2000 years history. I have 800 years history. My forefathers, they were the kings, they were the queens. There must be many kings, queens and another. So by better we start from the 1950, January 26th, where we have the exact, from there it will come. Then there is no competition, we are all equal. We can really enjoy. That is the day we are expecting.
So well said. And you know, one of the things I was reminded of over the last year, I've been working on some writings from the 1920s to 1947-50. And at that point, you realize that these ideas were not automatic, you know. It took something like 30 to 40 years worth of introspection and debate before the nationalist movement went in that direction. So to see them disappearing or being trampled on today is, it feels like a rejection, really, of the true past, in a sense. But Mr. Krishna, to come back to you, I was thinking of your movement, your insistence in a way that music and art should be taken away from the sabhas, you know, that it should start to move outwards towards the fishermen's communities where you've started a festival for the last 2 or 3 years. And again, you know, getting back to that question of happiness and joy which we've been discussing, you make a distinction when you talk about this. You say the joy is something that is fleeting. You know, when you finish singing, you feel it, but you know that it's also something that you're not going to hold on to. And happiness, you see, is something that is far more complex. Does it come to you out of this work of trying to take music itself out into a broader space? Does it come from inside your practice?
Yeah, I think first, it's for an artist, this world is very dangerous. Because again, we believe we are providers of happiness. We believe we are delivering this for people every evening and in fact doing a service to society in some fashion. So it's kind of a dangerous subject for us. And that's where the problem begins. The problem begins is the power of delivering joy or happiness. First, let's use it together, just for the sake of discussion. But the fact is, it is a fleeting happening. That the evening, you come there, somebody sings, or there's a play, or there's a dance, or whatever. And there is this happiness or this joy that you take back. But very rarely does that really change who you are, who the artist is. Very rarely, okay? And even if it does momentarily, the truth is we walk out of that door, 15 minutes later, we are the same rubbish that we were before. Okay? And somehow, and we forget that. We forget that, right? So the point is, how can this art or any art truly transcend that moment, that momentary joy or momentary joy that happens? I think that is the question that becomes very tricky. Can art really be more than just that evening? Can art really change the way we see ourselves? And I think for me, that was the fundamental question that began. And in that, I realized that it is not about, I mean, when you say take music out of the sabha, it's not about saying that everything inside the sabha is some evil being in any fashion, right? It's not that. But there is certain constructions within that environment that create problems with the way art is received or shared. If you can move it away from there, what happens to the art, what happens to the artist, what happens to the audience, what happens to the texture of the audience, all these things kind of dynamically change. Right? The question is, can we allow that to happen? And it is also not about taking art and, you know, giving it to somebody else.
Not at all.
No, not at all.
Did you see yourself change as well?
Yeah, I mean, tremendously actually. See, there are two discourses. One discourse is within the sabha, one discourse is out of the sabha. So there is already a discourse within the art, even if it is happening in the sabha. So that discourse is also as important. That discourse has to constantly be moving. And then you say, okay, take the space, change the space out. What happens? It changed incredibly. When concerts, when I started singing in, say, open spaces, you know, where the way that I saw the art, I saw myself as an artist, completely changed. There was a lot of rejection. There was a lot of, it was great to see people laugh at my music. Honestly, it was lovely to see people laugh at me and say, what is this? You know, that's something that you never see yourself doing. And that changes the way you reflect upon every note that you've been singing or every raga that you've been singing. What does it really mean? And in that, it's also important that it should transform to you coming in touch with every other art, truly inhabiting spaces of other art. The problem is that in society, we look at other things from the baggage or from the position that we already have. Is it possible for us to inhabit another space and experience it from that space? When that starts happening, then you turn around and reflect upon your art as if it's sitting over there and you're sitting inhabiting a different space. Then again, that also changes the way you see yourself, your art. So it is not just about one art form moving away from one space. It is about finding ways to share, finding ways to everybody to inhabit different artistic spaces. And seeing that the problems that exist in hierarchy and in perception and in ideas of sophistication, and ideas of purity, like you pointed out, and what can we do to share that? What can we do to inverse some of these perceptions? Can the idea of the Sabha itself be reinvented? Can the idea of the public itself, so the idea of the public and personal, that also comes into play here. So where is the personal, where is the public? So can we inverse some of these notions? And when we inverse these notions, what happens to our own perception of the people and the art? I think a lot of fascinating things happen. Not necessarily very clear or not clarity emerges, but I think a lot of fascinating things come into play. And in that little basket, I think there is some immense happiness. The happiness for me, I think, came from the fact that the more vulnerable I could make myself, I found that there was great happiness. And vulnerability also comes from taking, basically making yourself open to being extremely flawed, open to being completely the wrong side at times, sometimes not even knowing where you are, and actually struggling to find a footing. And the more vulnerable you get, and this has to be done socially, politically, and aesthetically, then I think what happens in the process is something, there's a fight there, there's huge battles, there's an internal battle, there's battle with people, because there is a problem in the perception that happens. But in that whole discourse, in that struggle, and I hope that struggle doesn't go away, because in that struggle is when you find happiness, because even you move a little centimeter in the discourse, and there is a smile, because you know that the discourse has moved that centimeter. And as long as we can keep doing that, I think that's where happiness is. And that's where I think I stay alive in some fashion.
I think there's tremendous freedom that also comes with stepping away from expertise, even when you spent years to build that up, you know, to put that label down and say, well, maybe the public, as you put it, has more to offer you than you might at that point. It's a very vulnerable position to put yourself in. And I just wanted to get back to something that both of you have been bringing up from time to time, this whole question of language, you know, and how important it is. And some of the terms that are being thrown around these days and that we were discussing when we started with this whole idea of what the country should be, you know, these words like nationalism and growth and development, you know. So now, when we hear them, they've been used in a certain way. They come with a beat of a band behind them, pretty much. And can you tell me what they should mean? You know, they're used so carelessly and so dangerously, they're pushing an undemocratic way of living down our throat.
This is very simplest thing to say, but it became so hard to speak about the nationalism in the country. Because I know how to live my own life, and with my own satisfaction, my consciousness, I am living. But there is no point that I have to be patriot or something, what they call nationalist or not. I don't know about that much. And when you talk about the nationalism, what nationalism you mean? What about that? Which nationalism? Do you mean that this kind of a discrimination? And do you mean that whatever you say, I have to agree? Yes, that is the nationalism. If I say that I can't believe this, and you build your nation only on the baseless, and you say that you are an anti-national, and you have a right to say like that, you can ban me anytime anti-national. With that kind of a circumstances, the person, the citizen of this country, are not unable to express actual feelings. If the citizenry has gone to that level, it is not good for the nation to survive at all. Which what exactly we are talking about? We talk about the something like a nationalism, all these things, and you talk about the culture, and you talk about the majority sentiments, and you talk, these are the words I hear. And how I paint in this country by my childhood, I know many things. I do have the sentiments. Don't think that only you have the sentiments, and I am here born only to follow your sentiments. That I cannot accept. Because this is not just your country. It is the country of everybody. That is what we are thinking. But all of a sudden somebody comes and says, see, from me, my childhood, we eat whatever we like. There is no restriction. This pure and particularly all these things. From the childhood, I have a problem. Pure, purity, all these things. Pollution, I don't know before. When we go and all talk. Because everybody calls us as a polluted people. That we don't take it so serious. But what we see, when you go in the hotels, they say a pure vegetarian, pure something. So it's something pure which is not related with me life. So let us take us then Swachh Bhiyana. Swachh, okay, after Swachh Bharat, my anger has gone up. Before also I had the Swachh pe thoda problem thi. Not just Swachh Bharat ke baad. So these are the major problems. When we are eating whatever we like, all of a sudden, they said that you cannot eat this. So I got so shocked actually. The place where we are, I born, that is the Kolar Goldfields, majority are Dalits. It is almost like 80%. What the Ambedkar dreamt, Dalit settlement, that there they can enjoy their own freedom life. That is the only one example where the Kolar Goldfields. 80% of Dalits particularly migrated from the majority Tamil Nadu and scavengers from the Andhra Pradesh and few others. This is the place where I born. So there actually, we never experienced this kind of a caste and all. There is no caste. Some officers may be, they may be thinking they won't caste. Labor, they don't have any class, any caste. Because we are one class. We believe the class, so we are all labor, so labor class. So labor enjoyed such kind of a freedom. So there, all of a sudden, they come started. And all our people said, you can do this kind of a ban anywhere in the country, not in Kolar Goldfields, but it happened even in the Kolar Goldfields. And there people started coming and stating, you cannot eat, you cannot kill, you cannot do this. And particularly beef, we are talking. We are now a country where we are unable to speak openly about the beef. The word is itself. You go to the Kerala Bhavan here in the canteen. So they said beef, and within the bracket they have started writing recently buffalo. And my home, we had many cows from my childhood. We have 8 cows. I know I can count all what kind of a color, everything I know. But cows is cows. In Telugu we call avu. Avu just like that, what we call like that, cow. All of a sudden, the avu has become the govu. I don't know the changes. Now you made your changes. And govu. Govu became go mata. And people started worshipping. And we do protect the cow. We know that when we want, we need to eat. That is our culture. Article 29.1 of Indian Constitution says very clearly, every state wherever you live, and you may have your own distinct culture. That is the state responsibility to protect the distinct culture, language and script. But where we are moving, I don't know. All of a sudden you come, somebody is a puja, you do puja, I have no problem. I am a person who eat, and let me eat whatever I like. So when it has become like whatever I eat also, somebody has decides. I felt there is a something big problem the country must be facing today. We are not addressing or talking about that. This one example is more than enough where we are really leading, where we are all moving, and no voice is coming. And when you want to say that, how can you eat, somebody comes and makes some noise or something. Whatever you make, but I am talking about my constitutional right. I am not asking you that, this is my taste, I want to eat. No, it is, may not be my taste also. But I have a right to eat whatever I like. I have a right to wear whatever I want to wear. I must have a right to speak whatever I feel. If it is not happening, then there is a danger. And such kind of a fascist forces cannot be there in the country where we are all. We are not like this. The country where I, my childhood and my, when I'm there in the college also, I never felt the country can change so early, so quick.
And there, if it is happening like this, and my opinions also. Somebody is creating some opinion and they throw on us, and they everybody speak. One person speak one language, across the country everybody speaking the same language. No, we cannot speak like that. This is not India. This is not India. I cannot be part of this India.
And what you're saying is again, you know, the imposition of force, the imposition of a kind of nationalism that's meant to override people's rights instead of protecting them. Thank you. Mr. Krishna, there was this, and I also wanted to ask you, you know, despite the steady loss of liberty on the country, you've seen attacks, I mean, I can't even name the list because it's so long, but on writers and artists including Huchangi Prasad, Piruman Murugan, Kopan, the late U.R. Anantamurthy, the Kabir Kalamansh, Nandini Sundar. Am I wrong to see some hope in the refusal of so many people to accept the injustices that are being perpetrated both in the past and now? Am I wrong to see signs of possible change?
Well, I don't know the possible change. That's a different idea. But I think there is hope, definitely, in the fact that there have been so many people who have stood up. But the fact is, the word nationalism itself is a bogus. I don't believe nationalism has any meaning. In fact, nationalism as an idea, to me, is a violent idea. Anybody who talks about nationalism is perpetrating a kind of violence. So to think there is different kinds of nationalism itself is for me problematic. I think there is a connection with the land that you are in. And there is this Tamil word which I love, which I'll use, called Patru. And it's not just a sense of belonging. It's almost something you breathe. You know, it's a fragrance, it's a touch, it's everything that is there with where you are. And that's what it is that we hold so beautifully with the place we are in. It is not the name India. It is not the passport. Or it is not this culture, another word, which we just perpetrate with such ease. Indian, there is no Indian culture. There are cultures that inhabit this land. I don't even know whether I should call it Indian. Just cultures that inhabit this land. So first of all, the moment we hear this word nationalism, we should really be fearful of what is going on. So we have to start there. Yes, we should be very, very happy that there have been so many people who have stood up here. But we should be parallelly very worried that it's still going on, that it's still happening on a regular basis. And there is this almost wave of people who think this is okay. That is very worrisome, that people think this is fine. It's okay, you said, I mean, when Perumal Murugan issue had come up, the kind of arguments that were being made, saying that it's all fine because he said this in this book, that in this book, and therefore it's fine. And that it's also fine. We're almost getting to the point where we're saying violence is fine. I'm not talking about people who perpetrate the violence only. I'm talking about the people who watch the violence. That is scary. The people who are watching the violence are slowly saying, no, what to do? This has to happen. Somewhere we are saying that we have to control. We are saying that this kind of authority is important for discipline. We are bringing this sense of, you know, morality, of sense of control, sense of kind of rules. And we always say, you know, India is such an unruly country. People don't know how to follow rules. So we need somebody. We're almost going back to the days when there was a stick with every teacher in a classroom. And somehow we are imagining that India needs a large stick. And we believe that the present dispensation has a very large stick. Can't be anything more dangerous than that. That we think the stick is okay. And so in spite of all the positives, I'm very worried that we believe the stick is good. And I say we, I mean, as a larger spectrum. And I also think that it's important that among the people who do not believe in this, there has to be a way by which we all stand up for everybody else, irrespective of other differences. Yeah. That is another major problem. That irrespective of other differences, I don't think we are willing to come together on this one aspect. We seem to choose. We seem to choose when the liberal wants to be liberal. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's so ridiculous. So it doesn't matter if we don't agree with so many other positions that are taken. But if in this we don't come collectively, my worry is these voices should not remain the only voices. These voices, we should have a swell of people who are saying these are voices that really matter. And the idea of the majority, again, that's another, the moment we say majority of this country, we are definitely going towards a fascist regime. We are going towards a regime which says most of us think this way. And again, that is something that is being bought into, that the majority of people, and the whole principle of the Constitution of India is how the minority of the country lives. It is a question of how the most marginalized are treated, the most marginalized, the respect that is given, the dignity that is given, the rights that are given to the most marginalized is what gives dignity to the country and not the feeling of the majority.
I think both of you would be happy to know that you're in good company, because the views that you put forward on the nation were shared and articulated by Tagore in a series of essays on nationalism and against nationalism. You know, at this point, I think we should probably throw it open to the audience. I have just one last question for both of you, which is, when you look at each other's work and life and art, you know, what do you find so powerful and so inspiring about each other?
I really admire and respect Krishna's efforts, and that has given a result. And within the system, and with where fighting starting, is really courageous thing. So as now TM is very famous in whole country, no? You know that. Pay TM. The Prime Minister has made that.
I'm now very worried of the image that comes with Pay TM. He's just made me fascist and majority. So, I honestly believe that my journey is just in its beginning stages of whatever I try doing, I'll continue trying. I think somebody like Mr. Wilson really signifies for me what it means to get self-awareness to a point where you realize it is not about you. It's so, and I think it's incredible to watch a person like him, because considering where he came from, what he was fighting for himself, to recognize that, to recognize that the excuses that are given within the community have so many things hidden behind. And to recognize that what the others perceive you to be, I mean, is also a problem of theirs. I think that's probably the most evolved philosophical position that I have come across. I'm willing to throw Adi Shankara Ramanuja all into the dustbin. Honestly, I think it's incredible to incredible to be able to do that, to be able to absolutely do that, right? To be able to look within and see what is happening outside, and see the relationship. And I think that's truly inspiring. And just thank him. And unfortunately, he's not. He doesn't have an issue called TM, so I can't speak to the party for that.
No. We both. We don't believe that we are individually. We are doing something like, because we strongly believe that nation should build by all the citizens, not just like. Individual is thinking that, like our Prime Minister also sometimes, he thinks that he's alone is building the whole the nation. That is not good. I want to tell even to the Prime Minister, that is not good. If at all, if something is good is happening in the country also, everybody must be participating in that. We must build our own country, then we will want the country also, or whatever. Like we both also, we share together in this dignity and self-respect, this arena. We are part of that. I am not thinking that I am doing, and I think that he will never think.
Do you have questions? And if anyone's at the back, just stand up and put your hands up so that we can see you. The mic's coming around.
We have time.
Yeah, we have 10-15 minutes.
I'm Dushan. My question is, we spoke today about how there is a great degree of ignorance about the existence of the vulnerable or the oppressed. But I think a new problem has emerged, which is that for the past 2-2.5 years, two more things are happening. One is that in a very organized and concerted way, somebody is telling us that there are no victims. And the only victim is the majority, which has been so-called deprived for so long, or with all due respect, the armed forces, they are the only legitimate victims in the country, nobody else. That's the first problem. The second is that there is also an attempt to say that even if there is some victim, for example, let me take the demonetization example. Somebody says, you know, 100 people have died. So what? You know, it's all for the nation. So tomorrow somebody will say 10,000 people have died in the sewers. So what? I mean, the cleaning the sewers is also good for the nation. So there is a concerted political attempt to deny the victimhood of the vulnerable and accuse them of whining. So, I mean, the question or whatever, how do we deal with that? Thanks.
See, actually, this is not the question, of course. It is a good explanation he has already given. And it is really difficult for us. What are the problems we are facing? Because the country, mostly, whatever the problems we are facing, first I started, hunger, poverty, disparity in the men and women, and child mortality rate, all those things. And dowry, it has gone. It is not at all a problem now. We do feel some proud that we have given more money and we have received more money. We have gone to that level. So that is the another problem. But the problem is, actual problems silent ho gaya. They have set their problems and making all of us to make rounds around that. They are making. And the actual problem for me, actually, there in the Kashmir, those people who got the wounds on the face by seeing that, I felt that where I am living. This is my country. Here it can happen. For me, the Kashmir means it is not the land. Kashmir means the people who are living. For their dignity and their security is a matter for me. When it is not happening, it paints a lot. And somebody comes and says, threat is something else. Threat is nothing. Threat is actually this. And Vrinda also 2 days before, she said very rightly. And militarization is a form of the masculine symbol also. That has become a big heroism now. Salute for many things. Of course, national anthem, that we cannot say. That is another thing. And there in the cinema hall, so not just. Because I'm not going to cinema hall, I can't say. Even the public meetings also now, it is coming. Yesterday I attended somewhere. But that we have to see that our nationalism to express.
It even came in a concert, by the way.
Yes.
Oh, my concert in Bombay, in Veer Savarkar Hall. That's an irony. But I was in the green room. And I was suddenly told, sir, just 10 minutes, we'll have to wait because we have to play the national anthem. I don't know. So then I refused to come out. So I sat in the green room. I did not stand up. And the national anthem was played. And then afterward, I said, you finish all that, and then we will come. So even in a concert.
But at this point, you only have to stand in cinema halls. It's
all right. They didn't come up to you. Yeah, Sivet's death, actually, I want to make very clear. See, in the whole of the country, it is happening. It is not just anywhere, including the Delhi. Recently also it happened. Everybody knows, including the Prime Minister, Rashtrapati, everybody, the many delegations went and met. I don't go and meet any Prime Minister or President, but all others met. And given the memorandums. They know they are all away. But there is no answer for that anything. No action has taken so far. And even Supreme Court judgment is also there. We cannot allow any human being to enter into the silver line and manholes. And the country, I strongly believe that, has a capacity
to do that without sending the any human being. But we never did, including even today. It is still continuing. But when some incident happens in the Pathankot, if two people die, that whole attention of the country will take. When 1,370 people died under our nose in every city, we don't talk about that. So you make emotional blackmail of taking the emotions of the whole country also to the certain place where you put and ask everybody to make the salute to that. But when the problem, actual problem under your nose, scientists of this country, research institutes of this country, nobody has developed even a single apparatus which can clean the septic tanks. Septic tanks everywhere there. Every day people are dying. Why the silence? This criminal silence must be broken. We cannot allow our fellow human being to enter into the civil life. I think that kind of a emotion we must have today. That is the nationalism means. Then we actually, the citizen, when dying, to protect the life of the citizen is the most important than anything else.
And I think that answers Dushyant's question about, you know, what we are not seeing, the lives of the people we are not seeing. Any other questions? Yeah. Oh yes, there's one from the second row out here. The lady in the second.
Okay, so the first part is not a question. But it's just something I saw yesterday, I think. There was a talk by Jill Falloway, a director. Mm-hmm. So she made the sentence that protagonism is propaganda that protects and perpetuates privilege. Mm-hmm. So the question is that here pretty much everybody thinks the same. So how do you really get people who don't already think the same to start changing their thoughts?
I'm glad you asked that question. It's a very important question. This, in a way, it also continues from the question that he had asked. I think especially when you live in times when certain ideas are being forced, then we also have to look, why is it selling? We have to also think about, why is it selling? We can't not discuss that point. So there is a tapping into a kind of a fear syndrome. And it's such a deep-rooted fear syndrome. Let's not go into the correctness of it. Fear can never have correctness. It just exists, right? So we have to think why this fear exists. Therefore, I think the only way, in a way, this conversation between all of us is actually no use, right? We all pretty much agree, 80% more or less, in the sense of that. So how do we take this conversation beyond this room to people who totally have, say, an opposite view of this? That is, I think, the important question. So the only way we can challenge these notions of forgetting about the idea of the marginalized, forgetting that they exist, this oppressive nature is almost non-existent, is to find ways of building discourses with the so-called majority or whatever you call it, so-called fear. How do we address that fear? How do we address that sense that the ridiculous sense that something has been lost, somehow they've been deprived of something for so many years? How do we address those issues? How do we address it emotionally, in conversation, in discussion? And I think here it's also important what we are doing in colleges and schools. We keep forgetting that. We forget that in most colleges and schools in this country, today that sense that there's nothing wrong with the country is being perpetrated lock, stock and barrel by different people in different regions. So unless you're going to create a parallel conversation with all the younger people in colleges and schools, where they hear other voices, not on Facebook and Twitter, but actually from people and have a conversation, I think that's the only way we can take this forward. That we of course need to talk to each other also and look at nuances, but we also need to think about how we address that fear. How do we see that as being real? How do we see that as being real? How do we see that the baggage that is being carried for whatever reason exists? How does that happen? Only if we do that, I think, can this go beyond this point.
Thanks so much. I think we have time for one last question and then the audience being very generous about asking questions. And after this, we don't, I mean, we'll take the last question, but we can also carry on the conversation outside, and we should. Please, go ahead.
I just wanted to add to all that you'd said, and I had a question on a personal level, which is that oftentimes we have conversations with friends and family, and nowadays it's more than ever, it's about politics and everything is interconnected. And I feel, and I face this, is that you are talking to someone who is on the other side, and both of you are trying to be sane and thoughtful and not fall into the spectrum of, I don't agree with you, you're an idiot, and stop it right there. But I find it increasingly difficult to put across the idea I have without having a backlash, which is, you are trying to force your opinion on me, I am entitled to my opinion, and you don't seem to respect that. And also, you are reading the wrong things. So again, the echo chamber that you keep hearing about, that you aren't reading what I'm reading, and I think what the people you're following on Twitter or the people you're reading about are just creating a huge bubble. And the conversation ends, and you lose a friend, or you even lose your family member, because it doesn't end on a neutral note, on maybe you are seeing it differently and I'm seeing it differently, but it ends on a, you're not seeing my point. Mm-hmm. And that you are following the wrong people. And again, it sort of falls into, it gets into anger. So I think we have lost the ability to,
I think you're expressing it very well, because the family is where a lot of things start. You know, the family and your close circle of friends is where caste operates, pretty much. And is where a lot of discrimination also operates. So at some point, I mean, I'm going to hand this over to both Mr. Wilson and Mr. Krishna, but I'm going to say that sometimes you realize that you can't be soft and gentle. Sometimes you realize that you have to stand up for what you believe in, and you have to point out that the other person's practice is not just an opinion, it is oppression.
That's just a personal thing that I do. Mr. Wilson.
Well, I think this is a difficult one. There's no doubt it's a very difficult one. Right? I think we all fall into that trap very often, where we also stop listening. We also have to remember that it's not only the other side of the line that's not listening. We are also not listening. So how do we first get to a point where we don't push ourselves to that? I think that would be what I would ask myself. And I do ask myself, not that I succeed very often. But the problem is also there. The problem is that it's not a question of having a strong opinion or a strong idea, and a question of you being ethically right or the other person not being. But both these positions come from very deep-seated emotional triggers. Right? They come from very deep-seated emotional triggers. And that's why the anger comes in. It's not because ideationally you're different. It's because it's personal. Every one of these things is personal. It's about your home, it's about your belief, it's about faith, it's about whether I can eat beef. I mean, it's actually nothing to do with the animal. The whole cow thing, the cow thing is actually the most irrelevant aspect. It's the idea of the cow within me that becomes more important, right? So how can I not let that make me deaf to the other argument? I think if we can try and somehow negotiate that within ourselves, however often, maybe the texture of what we say will change. Maybe the language of what we say is. It doesn't mean you're being weak, or it doesn't mean you're not being assertive. It just means that maybe it will change. But it's not easy. I mean, it's not going to happen always. But maybe once in a zillion times, if it happens, the conversation there can proceed to the next level. I mean, that's the only way we can. In fact, there was another, I don't know, some platform, and my colleague on stage said about the Gorakshaks. So she said, I refuse to talk to the Gorakshaks. I have nothing to say to the Gorakshaks. I'm not certain that we should really be doing that. I think even the Gorakshaks, we have to talk to. We have to find a way to listen to the Gorakshaks. It may sound bizarre, but still we have to listen to the Gorakshaks. That's the only way we can build some kind of conversation, some kind, especially when things are being thrust, things are being put on your face every day. And in a way, this is almost like an ad campaign of a corporation, right? It is like any multinational ad campaign. We are having a national ad campaign, okay? And it just has ad changes. The character changes. It could be the PM, it could be the cow also. right? So it doesn't matter what it is. Yeah, so basically that's what's happening. So and it's also true in an ad campaign that, like any ad campaign, you're convinced by the ad. I mean, we are convinced to buy toothpaste based on ads. We are, right? So we have to consider that there is a certain psychology that is being built into it. How do we try and peek behind that?
I already gave
it. I think there's a question.
There is a question.
Yeah, no, I asked this with great trepidation, but I was very interested in what Mr. Krishna spoke about. When you spoke, Mr. Krishna, about the music being different when your friend and you, and you said it's a work in progress. I was just wondering, Elijah, if it's okay to request him to sing it or not? Explain it, sorry. You request it. Just a little bit.
What do you want me to sing? Sorry.
No, you spoke about that piece of music when you said that your associate and you decided to read it off the text as it was sung earlier.
Oh, you do.
So could you
even remember it?
I'm sure you do. You're still working on it.
That's okay.
I thought you were going to ask him to sing, and I was like, wow. I heard he was singing on the stairway up. So, let me just give it a quick context before I make any faux pas. Yeah, this is from a treatise. This is an attempt to recreate from a notated form. And of course, any recreation, reinterpretation of notated form come with its own baggage of problems. So keeping all that in mind, I would say you're about 30-40% close to what it could have been. The rest is, of course, we don't know. And I remember one line of it, so I'll just sing it. This is a raga that's very famous in Carnatic music called Todi. Okay, and anybody who's heard Carnatic music, it's a quintessential Carnatic raga. And actually, in fact, it was an imported raga. The history of it is very interesting. It's not very old, it is imported. But today, its sound embodies what the Carnatic sound is. And that's the fascinating part of art. So when we try to recreate this composition from the notation, it didn't have almost all the curves and the structures that we hear. So it went something like this. Okay. I'll sing the older interpretation and how we would sing it today. Kamala Ambike, Kamala Ambike, Ashrita Kalpa Latike. Anybody today sings this story, they'll get whacked and sent back home. Seriously. I would sing it like Kamala Ambike, Kamala Ambike, Ashrita Kalpa Latike Chan. This is how I would sing it today. So when I heard that, I was like, oh goodness gracious, don't tell me it sounded like that. Yeah, it was sounded awful though.
Interestingly, the previous one,
the perfect note on which to start.
Just one. Okay. The previous version is closer to what is called Shuddha Todi. Can you just talk about it?
No, that's Shuddha Todi is a lot of mumbo jumbo that we come to. It's a technical question. Amad, so Shuddha Todi is supposed to be like that and all. Please, it requires a. It's not necessarily true. Okay? It's because a lot of these things are assumptions. Shuddha Todi is an assumption that it didn't have these curvatures, right? Therefore, whether it was really historically like that is a different discussion. You want to call it Shuddha Todi, please do. I have no arguments with that. But was it? It's a little complicated.
Okay, so on that wonderful note, can we please have a big round of applause for our speakers? For those who don't know, if you follow us on Twitter and Facebook, that is Tulika Books and Indus Conversations, we will be uploading the video of this conversation very soon, so you can follow, share with your friends and family.
I would now request Indu from Tulika Books to come and give a small vote of thanks.
Why do I get the feeling no one wants this to wind up? Anyway, I guess all good things must come to an end. And it's all that's left is for me to say thank you. Thank you, Krishna. Thank you, Wilson. Thank you, Nilanjana, for a scintillating conversation. We could have just gone on and on. And this conversation, I'm sure, will create several other conversations in our own spaces, within converted audiences, unconverted audiences, family members, our colleagues, what have you. Sania, thank you very much for kickstarting and running around with the mic. thank you to all our friends. I'm not going to name them personally. They know who they are, who put this together and made this happen. This is the second in a series of conversations we hope will continue. We'll keep you posted on the next editions. And last but not least, to use a very good cliche, thank you to India Habitat Center for collaborating with us, the program desk of India Habitat Center especially, Shadab and his colleagues, the sound person, the person who served us tea, and thank you all for coming and making this such a big success. Thanks.
Thank you.